What's up, crew? I'm Curtin Trains, and today I'm going to show you how to build this. That's right, we're making a micro Clapton Helix zipper. Try saying that 10 times fast. If you need any of the tools or equipment in the video, I'll have as many links as I can down in the description below. And without further ado, let's get out to the workbench. Alright, so we are at the workbench. What you're going to need for this build is a drill, of course. I just got a 12-volt one that maybe cost 20 bucks at Walmart. Works just fine. You're going to need an ohms reader. The one I'm using is kind of an expensive one from USA Ohms Readers. It's the one that can do parallel, so I can go as low as I possibly can. Don't expect everyone to have one of these, but there's tons of ohms readers you can get for just like 10 bucks, 5 bucks. Little small ones, they do the trick just fine. This one's special because I can actually fire the atomizer on it, but you don't really need that. You just need the ohms reader part. Please do not check your ohms on a mod. It does work in emergency situations, but that's not like the way you should rely on checking for your ohms. There always could be something wrong with the chip. A good ohms reader will always read properly. We got fresh batteries. I'm using some LG HB6s. They have a 30 amp rating, so perfect for the low builds we'll be doing today. You're gonna want your wire of choice. I'm using some kidney puncher Canthal. We're going to be using 30 and 40 gauge for the Clapton portion and 36 for the Helix part. You're going to want some screwdrivers. We're probably going to be either using a 2.4 or a 3. I will decide when we get there. You're going to need wire cutters. You can use toenail clippers, actually. That's what I first used when I first got into this before I got the proper tools. But these do work a lot better. You can get them at Harbor Freight or any of those sort of stores. There you got this nice little tip, then you can get them nice and flush every single time. Toothless pliers, they're like a dollar or two at Harbor Freight. Your tool for your atomizer of choice, I use this one I got from Geek Vape with my Tsunami 24. It's kind of like a little skate tool. It's got two different sizes of hexes, and it's got a Phillips head. We got some swivels, which we're gonna need those for the Claptoning. I suggest ball bearing swivels, not these ones. These are just the ones that I have. I haven't gotten more, and I need to do that because these are starting to wear out. And when you're working with wire this thin, if the swivels aren't spinning properly, which we'll get to that later, the wire will snap on you. If it doesn't snap immediately, it'll snap somewhere halfway through it, so you really want to make sure your swivels are working properly. We got tweezers, ceramic tipped tweezers. You can use your toothless pliers, but the benefits of using ceramic tipped tweezers is you can actually get the hot spots out while you're firing it, so I found that that helps out quite a bit. So let's see. Oh yep, you're gonna need your juice of choice. I have some Cloud Junkies Ohms. It's a strawberry cream, one of my favorite juices, like, hands down. It's only, like, 25 bucks. I think that's with shipping, too. 25 bucks for 120 mils. It's a pretty good deal. I'm pretty sure I skipped over this. The cotton I'm using today is Kogan Dough. It's what I've always used, and it's a pretty renowned product outside of vaping for how pure of a cotton it is. And I have some nice, some pretty high-grade little scissors here. I think they're actually supposed to be used for cutting hair, and cotton's a lot like hair, so there we go. Now, without further ado, let's get started. Alright, so we're going to start with our 30 gauge. So before we even start with the wrapping wire and everything, if you're like me and you have long hair or you wear a lot of jewelry, go ahead and put that crap away. Alright, there we go. And we'll just do one of these so I can see. Alright, so we're going to stretch out Like an arm and a half length. I'm about 5'7", somewhere around there. So I just kind of hold the wire right here, stretch my other arm out all the way, give it a nice tug, and careful when you actually let go, because even though you give it a nice tug, that does not necessarily mean it is straight now. Yeah, I'm sure you guys can see this. It's still got a nice curve going on to that. And we're gonna go ahead and do that twice. All right, so now that we got our wire pieces, we're gonna be twisting one, to straighten it, we gotta twist it. So we're gonna be twisting one clockwise and one counterclockwise. So we're gonna come in here and make a 90 degree angle with our flat or toothless screwdrivers here. Go ahead and mount it on into the chuck. Alright, now that we got her all tightened down and centered, we're gonna grab the other end with our toothless pliers and we're gonna give this little girl a spin. So you don't really want to pull, or I mean you don't really want to spin. You want to get some nice tension going on there, not too much though because the wire is thin. And don't spin it as fast as you can now, and we're only gonna go for 3 seconds, so 1, 2, 3. And yeah, it's looking nice and straight. We're gonna come over here with the other end and grab it with our forefinger and thumb. And that does not seem like it was long enough, so we're gonna give it a couple more seconds. There we go. Alright. So now we just gotta do this again with the other piece of wire. And over here on my table, I have two pieces of masking tape. And one has a clockwise symbol and one has a counterclockwise symbol. So that way I do not get confused. Alright, so let's just do this again on the other side. Make sure you're flipped to counterclockwise now, or whatever is opposite from the way you did the first one. All right, now that we got both wires straightened, I'm gonna go back to the clockwise wire, put my drill back into clockwise position, and I'm gonna reinsert. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna clip off these 90 degrees that I've made, and I'm gonna make two new 90 degree angles. Just because those joints that were made after it got spun, they weakened a little bit. So we want this to be as perfect as we possibly can, because we're pretty much dealing with wire that's as thin as hair. Now I'll get my swivel set up into my vise. I usually just take this loop end right here, if you guys can see that, insert it on in my vise as high as I can go. I have everything pretty much propped up like 3 to 4 inches over the table. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna situate my little janky setup that I got going on here. All right, now that we got her attached to our swivel setup, we can start getting on this Clapton. So what I usually do is I take my 40 gauge and I'll take my tweezers instead of the needle nose pliers. And I will come over here, take off a little bit. Now this stuff is just so thin. And kind of thread it through over here and wrap it around that 90 degree arm that we made with the 30 gauge. Just a little bit. And then to get this started here, what we're going to do is just really gently get her going. And then we're going to come back a little bit over on itself, and then back again. All right, now that we got her started, I'm just gonna really slowly get her rolling here. About, a centimeter before I pick up the speed again. And I'll just, and this is kind of a feeling that you guys will get used to. Just slowly pick up the pace as fast as you want to go. It's not really a rush. So, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and get this guy clapped and up. Same thing I did at the start, and kind of go back a little bit, and then back again. We'll go ahead and clip our lead, and so I'm gonna go ahead and take a look here. Did pretty good. There's a couple screw-ups, but that's because I had to start and stop a bunch of times. For those close-up shots. Let's go ahead and get this clipped on out of here after we secure our spool. All right, now we got our clockwise Clapton. So what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna take my ruler here and make sure that this is 3 feet long. And it is. So what we're gonna do here is we're gonna cut this Clapton into three different wires, and gotta be really careful when we clip it, because we do not want to screw up our Clapton here, so. All right, there we go. We have our three clockwise Clapton pieces. So, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna go ahead and set these aside back on our clockwise placeholder here. And we're gonna grab our other piece of wire that was twisted counterclockwise. Let's go ahead and get these little guys off the table. So yeah, just do the same thing as we did last time, but in reverse. So I'm gonna go ahead and flip this guy back the other way and do a Clapton and counterclockwise, which is opposite of the way that I normally do it, so it might be a little weird, but in the end it should turn out a lot better. So yeah. So now that we got three strands of counterclockwise Claptons and three strands of clockwise Claptons, we're gonna take one of our piles here, and I grabbed the clockwise pile. So now we're gonna twist these three strands together, right? So now we're gonna twist them counterclockwise. So we're gonna make sure all of our strands are nice and parallel here. We're gonna hand start this. That way the chuck of the drill has something to grab onto. Because you want to make sure all these strands are nice and even and the same tension and torque is being put on them. So it's a nice even twist all the way through. So we're going to go ahead and install this here. Make sure it's nice and tight. That was the clockwise, so we're gonna go counterclockwise, which that is. Now, continuing to make sure they're all nice and parallel, and don't run your fingers too hard, so that way you don't screw up the Clapton, but yeah, because some of these wires are like twisted up, so we're gonna untwist those a little bit. Get them all nice and parallel. Alright, now that I got them all nice and parallel, I'm going to grab one end with my toothless pliers. Kind of grabbed onto it like a dingus here, but there we go. And now we're just going to slowly twist it up. Looks like it, came undone on this side. Yeah, you want to make sure you're squeezing real tight on the other side. Alright, now I'll try to get some macros to show you guys where I'm twisting this to. But I don't want it to snap. So I've been twisting, because some videos you'll watch, they'll be like it snaps at the chuck or up there. Yeah, but there's always the chance that it can snap, like, in the middle or where you don't want it and wasting wire and whatnot, so I always try to be safer than sorry. And, that seems to be about where she goes, so I'm gonna grab with my forefinger and thumb on this side and slowly release, because it's gonna want to spin back. And it does. And yeah, there we go. Now we got a finished product here. Alright, so now we're gonna do the same thing to the other set, but once again, turning it the other way. So we made these Claptons in a counterclockwise formation, so we're going to spin them in a clockwise formation. Alright, so now that we got the other one twisted up, we're gonna line these suckers up and take a look at them through the macro lens real quick and make sure that they're the same twist. Alright, so we're looking pretty good, except the one that was twisted counterclockwise, the one we did first, it looks like it just needed to be twisted a hair more, so I'm gonna go ahead and do that. Now I can already see with my eyes that the other one now needs to be tightened just a little bit. And you kind of play this game. Don't try to get it too perfect. I mean, try to get it as perfect as you can, but don't waste your time on it, because really you can't get it truly perfect. Okay, that was actually pretty perfect. So now what I'm gonna do is helix this thing. So where did I put my 36? We're gonna take our 36 gauge. Well, first thing is first, actually. We're gonna take our 36 gauge. And then we're just going to wrap it in between those grooves. Just like that. And then I kind of wrap the rest of the tail around. Squish down a little bit so I can put it in the chuck. Get it nice and tight. And, how I usually do this is I'll hold the spool with my ring finger and my thumb, and then use my pointer finger to kind of lead the wire. And you want it, so you kind of want the wire at that angle. right? So parallel and like that. I'm actually gonna focus. Yeah. That did focus it, right? Yeah, that focused it. Okay.
Alright, so slow but steady. Gonna get this guy started. Oop. Going the wrong way though. Oop.
Yeah, with this part, you kind of really do want to go slow. I mean, it doesn't take that much time anyway, so. Yeah.
Still, I venture someplace scary, ghostly, haunting, I turn loose. Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice!
Alright, we're getting to kind of a sticky part here. You know, I'm actually kind of being a dumbass. Usually what I do when I do this, actually, is I'll attach this, these extra leads to my swivel. I don't know why I didn't do that. Alright. Go ahead and take a look here. Yeah, that looks really nice. I'm not sure if I want to leave it with, one helix or put a couple in there. I don't know. Yep, I have decided we're gonna leave her right like that. Cause, I also don't want to go too crazy with adding a bunch of wires. Cause I'm shooting for a specific resistance. Hopefully, when we get down to the ohm meter, this thing's going to be about, 0.3 ohms, hopefully. Cause, the last time, the coil that's in there currently, I did the exact same thing, but with only two strands and no helix. So I'm adding two wires as it is. I'm also removing a wrap too from the last coil. So yeah, let's see. All right, now that we got both these helixed, I am going to really lightly now kind of tighten them back up one more time. Same with the other guy. All right, and then you just want to come through and make sure that your helixes all line up, which they do. So now what we're going to do is anneal the wire. What you need for that is your handy-dandy blowtorch. Got a vise here. Oops, excuse the rattle. We're gonna just take this guy, put it on in there, all nice and gentle-like, and let's see, I'm gonna see if I can't make it a little darker in here so you guys can see what I'm doing. Alright, so now we are, I don't know if this is gonna be any better for you guys, but we'll find out together. So now that I got this side nice and securely, let's just make sure it's nice and secure in there. Gonna grab this end with my toothless pliers, but you turn on the torch, keep it at a nice low, yeah, can you see that? There you go. Nice and low, you don't want it too hot or too much because all these wires are really thin and delicate. We're gonna grab the top end, and we're gonna really quickly, really lightly pass over this wire. I don't know if you guys are able to see this. I'm not letting it get really red or orange. Or I'm not letting it get orange, I'm letting it get red. Like just barely red. We're gonna go over it once here. Then we're gonna go over it again. And all together, we're gonna go over this three times. So, yeah. See how it's a lot easier the second time, too? That is if you guys can see. I'm not looking at the cam right now because I really need to focus on this. Because if you linger too long on a certain part, even though we got it at a pretty low heat, the wire will melt and it will snap. We gotta really
be controlling this heat right now and making sure no spots are getting orange. Alright, and we're gonna do our last pass right now. Alright, and there we are. Give it a nice, firm, not a tug. Tug's not the right word. We're gonna make sure there's some nice tension on here. And then we're gonna slowly, kinda wanna give it a second, although it does cool down quick. It is still warm. And there we go. And it looks like, I'm pretty sure you guys will not be able to see this part, but it looks like there's a kind of a gold color to it now. That's the other thing about annealing the wire. You don't get the pleasure of getting those nice color shots. Not that I even do that anyway, because I'm using Canthal, which doesn't really produce that much color. You can. I've made posts on my Instagram where I got Canthal to color for me, not by much, and then you throw it through an Instagram filter and it actually looks pretty nice. Alright. And we're just gonna do the same exact thing on this guy here, so yeah. Alright. Let's go ahead and get this out of here and wrap them up. Alright, so I'm gonna check this guy out again for reference. Cause this is a 0.45 ohm coil, and I'm shooting for a 0.3 ohm coil for a series build. And zippers are my favorite coils. I've noticed they just have the most superb flavor ever. It's just, I don't know, I'm partial to them. I need to try some staples. I think last time I used a 3mm bit. I think I'm gonna do that again. One of the advantages of using a bigger bit for this sort of wire is it is really springy. That's what we did with the annealing process. What that does is it takes all the spring out of the wire. That's also why we twisted the wire the way we did through this whole process, was so that it'd be less springy when we actually get it here into our vise. So I'm gonna go ahead and get this inserted here. Make sure it's as parallel as possible and as even as possible. Want to make sure all those helixes line up. Might not actually line up on this guy here because I didn't get it that even this time, guys. I'll be honest. Not too even. Man, looking at the wire I got here, though, I'm hoping I have enough for a dual coil. I really, really hope I have enough for a dual coil. So when you wrap in parallel, you really want to make sure that vise is in there. Good. Let's get this out of the way. And let's get to wrapping. So last time, I did a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 wrap. So this time, I'm going to try to go for a 5 wrap, because I don't know if you guys can see it. I mean, it fits, but kind of feels like it barely fits, and there's a little bit of ramp up time, so. That, we really don't have that much wire as is, so. Gotta make it last anyway, right? Alright, so this first wrap's really important. I usually just come in here with my fingers and my thumb, brace it, and kind of, you want to fold this wire over, kind of. Kind of let it do its own thing a little bit. So you grab down here, make sure these are nice and even. There we go. And I'll give it a little wiggle, and I'll kind of, so I wrap away from myself, and I'm pulling this towards myself.
So that way it kind of makes a real good bite in there. Hopefully it remembers. We're gonna carefully take these wires and keep them parallel. And as I said, kind of fold it on over. And we're gonna be doing 5 wraps today. Got my wraps on there, and I'll always put one more wrap, because check this out. As I start to release this, even though we annealed it and stuff, it still wants to spring back on us, so I'm gonna fiddle with this a little bit and try to get it as tight around the bit as possible, and I will see you guys in a second. Alright, well, honestly, I think that's about as good as I'm gonna get this thing. There's one more technique I can try here, and that is taking both the leads like this, sticking them in the vise. Now we got that nice and clamped down. I can really pull on this. Nice little twist. And there we go. So I found that the leads you'll never get them to, let's see if we can do that. You'll never get them to bow straight down. You'll have to do that when you stick the coils into the actual atomizer. So let's go ahead and snip off some legs here. And I'm gonna go ahead and see if I have enough for another coil. Honestly, it's not really looking like it. So, yeah, we'll find out. Oh. 2, 3, 4, 5. Sweet. All right, we have just enough for dual coils. Awesome. I'll admit I was gonna be a little disappointed in myself if I couldn't have gotten at least a dual coil out of all of that wire. You saw that? That was at least like, it just shows you guys how much wire goes into a coil. Sweet. On to what, stage 3, 4? Let's get her hooked up into the atomizer. All right, so we are down on our ohm meter and let's go ahead and get started, shall we? Down and then we're gonna go ahead and wick her up and juice her and vapor. All right, we got her wicked, and today I'm gonna be using, as I said earlier, some Cloud Junkies Ohms. It's a strawberry deliciousness. Now we got her juiced with some delicious Cloud Junkies Ohms, and she's now ringing out at 2. Or 0.24. Interesting. And, oh, wait for it.
Oh, there we go. Oh, there we go. Yeah, all right. Well, let's see how she does on a little bit more power, shall we?
All right, so we are back up top, and I got the Tsunami 24 now mounted on my Noisy Cricket 225. It's in series variable voltage mode because I did a little bit of math, and I think I'm going over my battery limit, so I'd rather be safe than sorry. Let's see how she vapes. Yeah, this guy chucks. This is not having the ramp issue as the other one. Here, let's get some, get it a little cloudy in here, huh? Man, that's hot, too. Damn. Wow. Yeah, that kicks hard. Yeah, definitely would not put this on a series box. It would, for one, it'd probably blow up the battery. For two, probably kill me just because of how much vapor I'm getting. Holy crap. Like, here, I'll do another one without the cap on. Check this out. Look at that. I'm pressing it down now. It's like instantaneous. Well, yeah, I think I found my new favorite coil build, guys. Yeah. I think that's it for the workshop portion. Let's go back to the room. All right, we are back in the room, and it's been about 2 weeks since I built the coil, so I'm going to do a little mini review on it. So, let's talk about wicking. This thing is crazy. You can drop juice on one side, and it'll just go whoop right to the other side of the coil. So, because of that, I've only been having to change my cotton about once a week, which is amazing for me because I vape like a frickin' chimney. Usually, I have to change it every couple days. Same is kind of going for the batteries too. They're LGHB6s. There we go. Which have 1500 milliamp hours, and they've been lasting me almost like 8 to 10 hours a day, which is really impressive for me. I run it at 6 volts on a Noisy Cricket 225, so I'm pushing it as far as I can on the mod that I can. And yeah, it lasts a long time. The flavor is off the freaking chain. It's literally like drinking the juice, but not. You're vaping it. It's great. Like, mine's a strawberry cream. Here, let me show you guys really quick. Ugh. Thick, juicy, flavorful clouds. It's literally like I have a glass of strawberry cream drink. Or something, but I don't. I have my vape, and it's awesome. So, yeah, I think I'm going to wrap it up here. Once again, if you guys need any of the tools or equipment you saw in the video, links will be down in the description below. If you guys liked the video, you know what to do, and if you didn't, you also know what to do. But, yeah, without further ado, I think I'm going to bid you lovely people a good night. Remember to stay awesome, and the carnage reigns.
I got something good for you.
It would help if I turned it. Just like last video, would help if I turned it on.